come up and speak. So I never saw the Grateful Dead. I only saw about 150 post-Jerry shows. So somehow the Grateful Dead and I never crossed paths until 2005 in Atlanta, Georgia. I went to a Rat Dog show, and Jimmy Herring was sitting in, so he had his lead guitar, and Bobby had already started adding Grateful Dead songs to his lineup. And there was enough phantom DNA in that music from the Grateful Dead that I was attracted to it. But you know, I was just a visitor coming late to the party. But I was fascinated by all of it. The people, the culture, and how the music seemed to tie it all together. But just to let you know how clueless I was, I didn't even know what a deadhead was. A friend of mine had to explain it to me. But after that show, I started traveling around the country going to other shows. And I probably saw every iteration of the band after 2005. I saw Phil and Friends at Red Rocks, and I was in New York City both times. A blizzard shut the city down, seeing Phil at the Beacon. I did make it to the show. And I saw the Third Coming of the Dead in Greensboro, North Carolina, on Easter Sunday. I saw the first three further shows at the Fox Theater in Oakland. So I guess what I'm saying is that I'm up here representing the Fare-Thee Well audience. Those people who were either too young or otherwise never heard Jerry play, who only came to the band after Jerry died. Which of course is why the Grateful Dead is such a phenomenon. Because they were still able to attract new fans like me when long after their heyday's over and after their band leader has died. Which I think is unique among rock bands. And maybe it's like Mickey Hart said, the audience is the Grateful Dead. And while Joel, who's been covering the band for 40 years, sees the legacy in retrospect, I see the legacy backward, because I've only been exposed to the interpretations of the songs rather than the originals. So sometimes, like other Grateful Dead, like other Fare-Thee Well fans, I'm surprised when I hear the original. Like, for instance, Viola Lee, which I've heard many times from Phil and Friends, Further, and others. But it wasn't until I heard the original that I really understood what they were trying to do with that old blues song. So it's like Dead & Company, probably 3/4 of that audience are too young to have heard Phil play, Jerry play. And Fare-Thee Well, we don't even know that percentage, but it's probably more than half. So after 10 years of observing this cultural phenomenon, when Joel asked me to revise the proposal and work on this project, I won't say it was fake, but I jumped.
There's a lot of visual aid. I'm going to see if I can get this up here. So this was an extremely complicated story. And the fact is that early on, Pamela and I would do these interviews, and we would just stumble over the questions because was that the 2002 tour? Was that the 1990? So this was Pamela's deal. We're going to put them on a whiteboard. I'm used to taking my stories out of little forged notebooks. This was like a whiteboard. But so this is the book. It starts here at a band meeting 4 months after Jerry's death, travels all the way down here, up here to where the Alpine Valley Reunion, and down to the end of Further, up here in the Fare-Thee Well, the little Chicago thing. There's a lot of extraneous notes. This was so important. I can't tell you how much we just consulted this 100 times a day. Glanced up, did that happen before? Oh no, it didn't happen before. And believe me, you go ask the people who were involved in this stuff, they're not going to remember. there's interesting things here, I'll show you. Like for instance, there are 6 versions of the Grateful Dead after Jerry. first one was the 1998 other ones that had Phil, but not Billy. Then the 2000 other ones tour, which had Billy, but not Phil. Then all four of them finally get together in version number 3, and they're called the other ones at that point to play this Alpine Valley Festival. But they have a good time, and they decide to hang out and do some more dates. Well, now they're going to call themselves the Dead, and they're going to shift the personnel around a little so we have the fourth version of the band. And that worked out real well, that 2003 tour. So they went back out the next year, didn't go as well, and they shifted personnel again, so we've got version number 5. This ends at a sort of sour spot, and here we have the 2006 Nadir, I don't know how to pronounce that word, 2006 bottom, closing the office, losing the tapes, selling the real estate, and they pretty much don't see each other or talk to each other until 2008, when Barack Obama, on his way to putting America back together, starts by putting the Dead back together. We played a gig on the night of the California primary. And then a subsequent benefit in Pennsylvania with the Allman Brothers during the campaign in the fall. And again, like they had a good enough time that they went back together again as the Dead and did a big tour again without really having much fun. And at the end of that tour, they were kaput. Leading to Phil and Bobby starting further and going out on that, which was supposed to be a brief adventure that lasted for 4 years. And at the end of that, Bobby Weir collapses on stage and is literally dragged off. And Phil sort of closes the book on that. And we're in 2013. And again, we're back in 2006. Nobody's speaking, nobody. And this 50th anniversary is coming. The thing about the 50th anniversary is I don't think the band really wanted to do it. But they couldn't get out of it. Deadheads expected it. The Deadheads envisioned it. The Deadheads demanded it. And that is why it happened. It's not because those guys wanted to play music together one more time. It's because they knew they needed to live up to their compact with the Deadheads. They've done very little for their fans over the years, but that they stepped up to. And you know, it was an amazing event when you look back on it. 80 songs over 5 days, and you know, some of it was really good. That's what I always said about Hurricane Calls. You know, six Hurricane Calls a week, 1,200 words a day, and some of them really good. I love this book. It's an incredibly dramatic story of people's wills being tested, of adversity, of challenges, of brotherhood, of battles, of just so much of the things that go into making great drama. And again, we have a redemptive conclusion. I'm telling you, I'm going to keep some of you up late to read this thing. I promise. Any questions?